welcome back to Play That Rock and Roll, where we take a look back at the albums and artists of the classic rock era. Today, we'll be talking about yet another supergroup. It's alright, we're going to the end of the line. So you may be wondering, what's the point of highlighting another supergroup? Some talented musicians get together and produce great music. Same old story, right? Actually, not really. The fact is, most supergroups don't exactly live up to that term. It was the heat of the moment, telling me what my heart meant. I have seen the word supergroup applied to woefully inappropriate acts. And I'm not trying to pick on Asia here either. I like Asia. But what sets them apart from a band like Styx or Foreigner? See, the term supergroup implies top-tier established artists working together to both create timeless music and enjoy instant success. But in reality, what supergroup actually means is a band made up of guys from other bands. This is less impressive and less interesting. Examples of what I consider to be true supergroups are bands like The Highwaymen, Cream, Crosby, Stills, Nash & Young, and today's subject, the Traveling Wilburys. But when supergroup gets thrown around so carelessly, they all get lost in the shuffle with lesser acts like Asia, Damn Yankees, Chickenfoot, or, oh god, Bad English. You see the difference, right? I mean, even the Power Station, who I love. Well, that term only applies to their first album. But, that second singer? That comeback record? Not so super. And again, I'm not trying to talk shit about any of these bands. Except maybe Bad English. I'm just trying to say that true to the term, supergroups are rare and special. And today we're going to talk about the group I think demonstrates this better than anyone else. The Traveling Wilburys is classic rock's greatest supergroup. So let's take a look at their all-too-brief story. Hit it! I've been bumped up and I've been fooled. The Traveling Wilburys are made up of George Harrison, Tom Petty, Bob Dylan, Jeff Lynne, and Roy Orbison. My God! Not to belabor the point, but do you know who Asia is made up of? The guitarist from Yes, the third guy from Emerson, Lake & Palmer, a guy who sang for a while with King Crimson, and one of the Buggles. Yeah, they had a Buggle. The Traveling Wilburys, on the other hand, had a Beatle. These are not the same.
I mean, there was always those groups in the 70s, they made these superstar groups, and we hated that, you know, the idea of these famous people all trying to make a record. Most of the records weren't that good, you know, it doesn't mean it's going to be good if you just get these famous people together.
So all five of these legends ended up in the same band, but how did that happen? Where were these guys that led them all to cross each other's paths at the same time? Well, Tom Petty had spent most of the 1980s producing bona fide hit records. He was at the top of his game and very high profile. In 1986, he teamed up with one of his heroes, Bob Dylan, for a massive co-headlining tour that lasted for 2 years. Dylan's 80s period, on the other hand, was enjoying less and less success with each release. He was becoming less of a pop figure and more of an elder statesman in rock and roll. Former Beatle George Harrison seemed to be headed in the same direction until he teamed up with super producer and Electric Light Orchestra frontman Jeff Lynne for a record called Cloud Nine, which led to a big career revival. I got my mind set on you. Although Jeff Lynne and ELO were still enjoying pop success deep into the 80s, his work with George Harrison marked the beginning of Lynne's transition from primarily a frontman to more of a producer of other records. One of the individuals he began working with after Cloud Nine was Roy Orbison, who had not produced any records since 1979. This partnership was of great interest to Harrison, who invited both men over to dinner, and you know what, I'll just let George explain.
I had dinner with Roy Orbison and Jeff, and I said to Jeff, look, tomorrow I'm just going to go in a studio and make up a tune, and do you want to come and help? He said, sure. Bob, we knew, had this little studio. I phoned Bob up. I mean, sometimes you can phone him and not get through for years, but he picked up first ring and he said, sure, come on over. My guitar was at Tom Petty's house.
Harrison makes it all sound very casual, very happenstance. Oh, you know, I just had these two guys over for dinner and we wanted to write a song, so I called Bob Dylan to see if we could use his studio real quick. And oh yeah, Tom Petty still had my guitar, so I had to call him to get it back. But here's the thing. Cloud Nine was done. What did you need a song so quick for?
In Europe, you know, they make those 12-inch singles and they usually like to have an extra song on the record. So they asked me for an extra song and I didn't have one already recorded.
I have to believe George is being coy here. There is no way he seriously believed any song with five guys of that caliber was appropriate for a European release B-side. It's widely considered that this whole B-side story was just Harrison's sneaky way of creating a new band. See, Harrison had a rare case of bizarro lead vocalist syndrome, as he was far happier playing in a band and collaborating as opposed to being a solo artist. And being an ex-Beatle means if you want to start a band, you're going to get A-listers. Okay, B-listers. Oh, never mind. So now that the band was assembled, what did they produce? I've been uptight and made a mess, but I'll clean it up myself, I guess. Oh, the sweet smell of success, handle me with care. Their first song is also their most famous. This is Handle With Care, which began as that soundtrack B-side discussed earlier.
There was Bob saying, oh, what's it called? What's it about? And I finally saw behind his door this big box with a sticker on it saying Handle With Car. I said, Handle With Car? He said, oh yeah, good.
Much like the Power Station's cover of Get It On, this song is what single-handedly convinced all five men to make a record together. Harrison sings lead, Petty and Dylan do background vocals, but Roy Orbison gets a show-stealing verse. That's why he's in the band. Nobody sings like Roy Orbison. The rest of the album sounds a lot like this song, and that's certainly not a complaint. All five guys are rhythm guitarists, so there's a lot of guitar, but there are no excessive solos. These guys do a fantastic job at sharing the spotlight. All five of them are perfectly capable frontmen, but no one hogs the stage, making it feel like a genuine collaboration. In the world of rock and roll, the idea that five frontmen would leave their egos at the door for a project like this is absolutely unheard of. Tweeter and the Monkey Man were hard up for cash. They stayed up all night selling cocaine and hash. Now, because Harrison, Petty, and Lynn idolize Bob Dylan so much, it is Dylan who sings lead on most of the album tracks. Dylan gets four songs on this record, so my only minor criticism is that it's a bit much. Congratulations for breaking my heart. Congratulations for tearing it all apart. Look, Bob Dylan can do a lot of things. He can write lyrics. He can arrange music. He can lead a band. He can inspire a generation. But the man cannot sing. All four of the others are better vocalists. Even Tom Petty, who you could describe as having Bob Dylan's vocals, if Bob Dylan's vocals were any good, and especially Roy Orbison, who they all also looked up to. I mean, just listen to this. It hurts like never before. Question about this record is, why did they not give Roy more to sing? Well, it's all right, riding around in the breeze. Well, it's all right, if you live the life you please. Well, it's the album concludes with my favorite Wilburys song, End of the Line. Now this, along with Handle With Care, are absolute essentials for any classic rock playlist. But I really recommend the whole album. even with the Dylan songs. Maybe that's just a problem for me. Traveling Wilburys Volume 1 was released in October of 1988, which eventually won them a Grammy. Tragically, Roy Orbison died just 2 months later in early December, at age 52. Between this project and the insane amount of effort he was putting into his big comeback record, Mystery Girl, which was completed in November of 88, it seemed he had simply worked himself to death.
I mean, we love Roy, and we still do, and he's out there, really, his spirit. You know, life flows on within you and without you, and he's around, you know, in his astral body. He'll be cool.
I'd like to say that Roy was one of the nicest people I ever met, and he was the best singer ever. So it's a real lust to the Wilburys, I might say, and to the world, really.
In 1989, Dylan and Petty both released solo albums along with Orbison's Mystery Girl. Since the Wilbury project was such a success, Lynn and Harrison provided studio help on all three releases. Petty's album was especially huge. A year later, the four men reunited to record a second Wilbury's album. Speculation was rampant on who might replace Orbison, but they all insisted this would not be the case.
And there was some talk about replacement, but...
It was talk in the newspapers mainly. We never talked about it. Because you can't replace him.
There was never an intention of anybody else joining, so that didn't happen.
It wasn't about getting another famous guy in the band, you know. That was not the point. And if it hadn't been, I don't think anybody would have fit in.
The thing about the Wilburys was it just happened, you see. And the moment you start to try and contrive, well, we could have this person, it'd be easier just to make a new group.
This was not a typical supergroup project that needed that role to be filled. This was a genuine collaboration between close friends who wanted a low-pressure, laid-back project to work on with each other. So in October of 1990, they released their second album, jokingly titled Traveling Wilburys Volume 3. Despite naming the record Volume 3, this album does not quite escape the sophomore slump. It is not a better album than Volume 1, but that's not to say it is bad. The album is loose, fun, and pretty easy to listen to. While there's nothing to object to here, there's also no standout single to really grab your attention. The closest we get is a song called Wilbury Twist. Ain't never been nothing quite like this. Everybody's talking about the Wilbury Twist. Alright, this is fun. Good representation of the album right here. A bit of a throwback, kinda silly, but at its core, quite enjoyable. Now, because this is such a freewheeling project, it runs the risk of being a little too loose, a little too carefree. I mean, Petty's got a song in there about proper guitar storage. And when you check the manual you kept inside the case, it said put it in a cool dry place. I guess I get it, but like, come on.
I think we made a more, little rougher record, a little more rumble and boom. And I wonder where she will stay,
my little runaway. I still give the album a thumbs up, so don't get me wrong. Songs like Inside Out, Whorehouse, and Runaway are all quite good. This one reminds me of the Beach Boys. All I'm saying is that while this album may not be an essential add to anyone's collection, it certainly wouldn't hurt. The unavoidable problem here is the lack of Roy Orbison. He was underutilized on the last record, but even then, he was that special factor that took a good album and made it great. So his absence here really hurts. Also, it is quite disappointing that George Harrison does not attempt to increase his own role. With Orbison gone, George had the best voice in the group. But he barely uses it, only sharing vocal duties on a few songs, leaving, once again, Bob Dylan to do most of the heavy lifting.
Bob sang a lot of the second record. He came up front more.
See, there's no major faults with this record, just a few missed opportunities. And unfortunately, this was pretty much the end of the line for the Wilburys. One of their songs ended up on a Cherry record shortly before Volume 3 was released, and they did some promotional interviews for Volume 3. But after that, they all returned to their solo careers. Petty released another blockbuster album, Harrison joined his ex-mates from that other band for the Beatles anthology project, and Jeff Lynne provided production work on both. Meanwhile, Dylan launched his so-called never-ending tour, which still goes on today, while he also entered the Get a Lifetime Achievement Award from every damn organization on earth part of his career. Now, these guys all continued to collaborate with each other. In fact, Lynne helped produce Harrison's posthumous final album, but nothing Wilburys related until a 2007 re-release of their entire discography in one repackaging. So, if you're gonna buy something Wilburys related, it should be this. Now, unfortunately, the band never lived up to the traveling aspect of their name, in the sense that they never toured. Not one live appearance. But it was often discussed.
So, are you gonna tour this project finally?
No.
No, why not?
It's tiring.
Because the Wilburys didn't go on the road.
I regret that we didn't tour it.
So you are gonna tour this record?
No. Never thought of in a conventional sense of playing arenas or anything like that. It was just, George had lots of ideas of unusual ways to do it.
But when are they going to travel with instruments?
Together, you mean to do a concert? Yeah. I don't know.
Ever thought about it?
Everybody, all the time, that's all everybody talks about. Mm-hmm. But at the moment, we don't have any plan. It's too tiring. It is for me. You know, doing night after night. And after the novelty of just being on stage singing, my baby wears off after a few nights, and you think, what the hell are we doing here in Philadelphia in some crappy motel?
Petty and Lynne both expressed an interest in touring, and I imagine Dylan would have been up for it, but Harrison would just not commit. And whether he liked it or not, he was the de facto leader of the band. So the plan for live shows, and even a third album, got put off again and again until it was too late. Harrison passed away in 2001. So if you want to see these songs on stage, you'll have to check YouTube for old Harrison clips, or hope Petty or Lynne plays one in their respective live shows, as they occasionally do. Dylan does not. In fact, I can't even find interviews where he talks at all about the Wilburys.
The hell's his problem?
There's no dark side to the whole Wilbury story. It was just all optimism and fun, and there was nothing naughty about it.
Harrison, Lynne, and Petty have all said the Wilburys project represents some of the most joyful and positive moments of their careers. And that really shows through, as this music demonstrates how uplifting and accessible rock and roll can truly be.
So if you like music that makes you feel good, I would check this out. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time. Well, it's all right, even if the sun don't shine. Well, it's all right, we're going to the end of the line.
Right here on MTV Music Television.